All right, well, I think we should go ahead and get started. Happy New Year, everyone.
Happy New Year.
I'm gonna go ahead and sorry about that. It looks like we have enough folks. I'll go ahead and, hi Kathy. Moving forward, I'm gonna read the emergency
Hi everyone.
Order.
Happy New Year.
Hello, Happy New Year. So keeping with the ongoing emergency order from Governor Charlie Baker, limit gatherings and maximize social distancing and under legislation passed to address remote board meetings. During the emergency declaration, this meeting will be conducted via Zoom. Attendance by committee members will be remote, and remote attendance shall count as quorum. The meeting will be broadcast live and recorded on ECAT. While conducting meetings remotely, we'll endeavor to keep meeting operations as close to standard procedures as possible. While committee members will be on video and audio, public participants will join the meeting muted, and with no video feed, public lines will be muted throughout the meeting to allow the board to conduct the business for general meetings, and only for items in which the chair solicits public comments. Members of the public participating in the Zoom meeting may submit a written question in chat, provided they include their full name and address for the public record. If you have a question and you're viewing on ECAT, you can submit those questions via email to mblanchard@easton.ma.us. Any questions not addressed in the meeting may be answered afterwards via email and will be incorporated to the meeting minutes for public record. All votes will be by roll call, and when all business indicated on the agenda has been completed, the members will vote to adjourn the meeting, signaling the end of the meeting, and then participants will disconnect from the meeting at that time. So to ensure that we do have quorum, I'm gonna go ahead and ask our committee members to identify themselves in alphabetical order.
Greg Blanchard.
Karen, it looks like there's a couple people still in
attendance. Oh, Beth is here. Okay, let me promote her.
And Kelly.
Thank you. And Kelly. Okay. Thank you. Thank you. All right, Beth will join right in time to go ahead and say she's here in alphabetical order. Okay, so Craig.
Liz Bornstein.
Oh, Devonshire present.
Foster.
Grant.
Oh, sorry, Michelle.
That's okay. I'm like scrolling through the alphabet here.
I think that is Amy.
Oh, sorry. I did say Gershman here.
You did. Okay,
at the same time.
Sorry.
No problem.
Ramona here.
Archie here.
You and Chan is here. So go ahead and call the meeting to order. This is our January 4th Human Rights Committee meeting. I did send out the agenda to the group. Have folks had the opportunity, I'm hoping, to review so we can go ahead and approve the meeting minutes that Kristen sent out? Do I have a motion to approve the meeting minutes?
So moved, Barger. She did a nice job.
I'll second.
Thank you. Okay, can we go ahead and vote in alphabetical order?
Barger, yes.
Bornstein, yes.
Devonshire, yes.
Durant, yes.
Austin, yes.
Gershman, yes.
Moore, yes.
Archuleta, yes.
And Chen, yes. Thank you. All right. The next item on the agenda is actually 2022 activities and event planning. And actually, I thought as we're starting to think about our event planning for 2022, it would be best to actually reflect on what we were able to accomplish in 2021. So great timing for that, because our annual report is due to the town, and I started to draft that with Allie, and Liz took a look at it as well. So I thought we'd pull that up for the group to take a look at, and this way we could all kind of see what we were able to accomplish in 2021, what we want to be able to bring forward and move forward with in 2022, and go from there. So Allie, do you mind sharing that on screen?
Sure. Just give me one second.
Thank you.
Okay. Are you able to see that?
Yeah.
Perfect.
Thank you.
Sure.
So our 2021 calendar, it's a kind of in this bottom section of the document, but really we kind of started off the year as a reminder. We did the art contest. This was our Rise Up for Humanity art contest, where we chose a winning piece of artwork and turned it into stickers and vinyl decals that we then went ahead and distributed to the community. That was definitely a fun project. We were able to continue the effort around the religious holidays observance calendar and get that distributed to the schools. And that continues to be a reference document that we're continuing to hear pretty positive feedback on. So I think we probably want to continue that effort going forward. We were also able to host two listening sessions this year, one around gender identity and the other around physical disabilities. Definitely received some really good feedback on both sessions, gender identity too, and as well as the physical disabilities. Amy did such a great job in terms of updating our website. Our website to include all the resources and presentations and documentation that was leveraged during the conversation and even shared with us afterwards. So definitely kind of ongoing information that we have available to community members as well. We also hosted the collaborative art project at the NRT Harvest Festival with our with the feathers, the thousands of feathers that were cut out for that project. Our messaging was around surrounding diversity, specifically in diversity, there is beauty and there is strength, and Maya Angelou reference there. And we most definitely had a really strong participation across the community in that art project. So that was a lot of fun. From there, actually, the art project has actually now been moving forward. So, Allie, where did it first go? Was it to the Council of Age on Aging?
Yep, it was at the Council of Aging for a month, and it's still at OA as of right now.
Yeah, and it's a monstrosity. So whoever hosts it for us, you know, kudos to them for wanting to take that on and sharing that with a group. So it is at OA. I asked my daughter if it was there. She said yes. And she said, quote, Mommy, it's really big. So it's definitely there and it's definitely visible. So that's pretty exciting. We also managed to order and distribute the Hate Has No Home signs to the community. I actually still have about maybe 50 left. So we can think about maybe our next event and how we want to go about distributing those. Or if you have folks that are interested, definitely let me know. I have them here in my home. And then finally, we were invited and participated in the annual Lions Club Festival, where we were able to march to the rockery for the festivities. And that actually was a lot of fun. My first time at the parade, and I've lived in the town for over 10 years. So I'm happy to have been able to be a part of that. Did I miss anything from this list? Anything else kind of come to mind from the group that I didn't get a chance to capture?
One thing that I'm reminded of as you went through it is that the artwork from the art contest, we also put onto shirts for committee to wear, so I'm not sure the best place to put that.
Thank you. Perfect. Yeah, so I mean, it's a pretty impressive list. I think, you know, as we kind of, having been part of the committee since 2016, I know it took us a little bit to kind of get into a groove and figure out what types of events and activities we did want to move forward with and participate in and what new things we're going forward. So, you know, in 2021, I think at the end of 2020 is when we started the listening sessions, and then we're able to do two this year. Thoughts around maybe kind of continuing that forward, and thoughts around you and any kind of continuing that forward in 2022 and any particular topic.
Sorry, Karen. I think there may have been a couple of either book or listening sessions we did with multicultural kids event, and I sort of dropped out of that group and stay with it, but I think we did sponsor a couple of others. So we should get her input. And Amy, you might know because you always design all their flyers.
Yeah, I don't, they haven't done one recently. I can go back through my records.
I think they did something over the
summer. Yeah, we definitely did and work with them over the summer for some sessions.
Okay, yeah, if anybody wants to share those with me, I can definitely include. I have a line that just kind of talks about performing outreach to influential community partners, schools, library, and other groups. And then I also have one that talks about collaboration, I think, with just other groups within town. But if we have any specifics that we wanted to include, please send them to me and I'll make sure I get them added. Okay, well, great, impressive list for the HRC in 2021. And now as we kind of think about our 2022 activities, I thought it would be good to at least start to think about what we wanted to do going forward, what maybe we don't want to repeat in 2022, anything. I know I missed the last meeting, but I saw in the meeting minutes, we had Esme come and talk about a potential event maybe in the spring. Do we want to start to kind of plot out what maybe each of the major seasons will bring for us in terms of activities, so at least we can start to lock some things down? Thoughts from the group on that?
I think doing a Pride event is appropriate and a good idea, especially because it didn't end up happening last June. So now that we have some time to plan, I think that would be important, particularly if we've already identified some partners willing to do work as well and gather people as well.
I didn't get a chance to meet with Esme like I'd intended, but it's definitely on my to-do list sometime soon. I'm wondering if we want to plan have like a subcommittee to work on it if anyone else is interested. And we can plan something, pick a date, and we can all help brainstorm ideas.
Yeah, I'm happy to help. I just don't, as far as timing, if we wanted to be true to form, we could do it in June and then maybe do something before then. So, but as far as months go, but happy to help.
Okay. I'll try to coordinate with Esme and include you too, Beth and Michelle.
Okay.
I wonder if we should think of a training offer something in between that. That's something that we could offer in the spring, maybe in March.
Yeah, and we had a couple of topics that have come up that I don't think we've had an opportunity to move forward with, unconscious bias being one of them. You know, and I know we're going to talk a little bit more around the proclamation in a little bit, but the proclamation does talk about privilege. And I do think, you know, along with kind of introducing the topic to some people for the first time or just kind of reiteration of the topic, a training to go along with that or programming to go along with that would be good. So I don't know if, you know, folks have any resources or connections. Amy, I remember the person that we worked with to bring forward maybe the discrimination and racism training for families.
Yeah, Liza. I'll reach out to her and ask her
Liza.
Those topics.
Excellent. Thank you.
You think she'd be interested in running something maybe in March?
I'll ask.
Good.
If we're brainstorming ideas, I'm wondering about stuff in the minutes about distributing both the extra hate has no home here signs as well as possibly getting more t-shirts with the artwork to sell and distribute. And I think it works well to do that in conjunction with other events. I was trying to think of what might be coming up, sort of February, March, April. And the only thing that came to mind was Hazardous Waste Day, which is end of April, I feel like. But that could be an interesting like partnership, you know? So they're probably better fits, but.
Hey, what about our food truck idea?
Food and hazardous waste.
Hazardous Waste Day does bring out a lot of people from town.
And they're already kind of in a line. Yep. So it's possible we could catch them like at the beginning and the end if DPW feels like there's enough space for us to do that safely.
Mm-hmm. Good thought. So should we, Craig, could you contact the town, see if we're allowed something like that?
Well, I know that we've used that time for political campaigns, so I can't imagine that the town would have an issue with it, but I certainly can ask Dave Field about whether that would get in the way of anything. But we can do it. I mean, there's plenty of room out front and then across the street.
Could we combine the food trucks with the Pride Parade? And weren't we going to do the dance party thing too?
Yeah, the tea dance is hard. Actually, that would be fun if we did food trucks and dancing. It would just be finding a place to accommodate.
Do we know people who have a food truck?
I know that I grew up in Somerset. They've had food truck festivals at least 3 times now that seem to be pretty successful. So I can, and they post their stuff online, so we could probably just contact whomever the organizer is and find out. But they have at least, I would say, half a dozen, if not more, food trucks that come out. I think you just need time and before it, enough, you know, kind of posting or enough time to plan.
Yeah, you have to have permits too.
Have permits, and you have to have a location. And then I think most food trucks, they require a minimum guarantee of revenue for the day. But that shouldn't be an issue depending on where we tend to have it and when. I mean, I don't think we can make that guarantee for 15 food trucks, but for 3, we could probably swing it. I think it's a great idea. I mean, I love the idea of a food truck. Or 2 or 3.
That's more subcommittee type planning to parse out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but I think we haven't, I mean, Easton, I don't remember any food truck event in Easton. It might be something that would take the city by storm.
Sometimes the recreation department does a summer concert. Maybe you could partner with that. They do it at Frothingham. So they would already have the music component, music and dancing. And maybe be able to bring in like our cables and the food trucks and kind of partner with them. And another partnership with them we could look into is to have something set up during children's races during the summer. That's every Thursday, the entire summer.
I spent many a Thursday there. What has the picture to prove it?
I do. Yeah.
Years ago, we had the cultural council up at the Ames Mansion, and they had a food truck. I don't know. I'd have to talk to Carol and find out what their plans are, given COVID and all that.
I like the idea of aligning it with something that sort of aligns with our mission, if we can.
So we could theoretically do something in the spring. So I've heard both training as well as distributing stuff, for lack of a better word, that we have signs, shirts, maybe extra stickers. We have Pride event sometime in June. There could be food trucks there, or we could move that to another event where you have a lot of people, which is children's races, which I feel like start like mid-July and go through end of August type of thing. So that could even be a different contact point for the community if you have like roughly April, roughly June, and roughly August.
And then in October, we have NRT, and then
it's December.
And then
that violates Karen's once a quarter rule.
Oh, sorry, Karen.
I think that's good.
We're getting ambitious. Ambitious.
The other thing, we are working, a few of us are, a discussion group around critical race theory with multi-race, which is a, I don't know where, it's going very slowly, so I'm not sure, but it could be in the spring.
So no timing on that one yet, Kathy?
No. But I also thought of another thing we could put on our list of accomplishments, to serve as a clearinghouse for human rights activities to the community through our ally.
It is a good one. And how big is our ally list right now?
It's 158 and growing.
There you go. There you go.
But they share the information with others.
Excellent. Thank you. What about listening sessions? Do we want to try and do another one in 2022? Any topics that we feel like we haven't had a chance to cover that we want to cover, you know, in 2022 that we didn't get to tackle in previous years?
We definitely had ideas in the lineup for sexual identity, I think. I know that we had some people willing to help out. I think we just burnt out on Zoom stuff. I don't know, we could try to coordinate it with the Pride event. We have a formula for it already if anyone, you know, wants to take the lead.
I think if we do a listening session, it should be sort of a now winter cold weather type of thing, because I have a feeling come the spring, people will again be like ready to be off a screen and just outside.
We could use it to promote a June event.
That's a lot to put something together though for like March at this point, probably the earliest, right?
I think we pretty much had all the people, you know, minus the dates. To help.
Okay.
I'm just trying to, I think March is doable or April, but I also, with the way in which COVID is working right now, I don't know if people want, I think there was more interest to sit on a Zoom than there was and than we might have right now. I think people are continue to be burnt out, even if they're they're not, even if they are at work. So I think we could run it and see what happens, but also know that folks might be inclined to just say thanks, but no thanks.
Who was the subcommittee? I think it was Michelle, you, me, maybe Kathy. Throwing you in there. Beth, I know you volunteered too.
But I kind of agree with Beth. You know, people are just tired. And not that it's not relevant, but everybody's like thinking about COVID and school and masks and all these more other things that seem higher priority for people right now. But I don't know that we would get that kind of, you know, what we want. I wonder if there's a more relevant topic we could think of, I'm hoping by the fall we can get together, you know, we can be outside and do things. So if you had something where people could get together, that would be interesting.
Fire pits are a blessing.
Okay, I mean, I don't, I don't think we have a lack of events and activities for 2022. So, you know, we can kind of table this and see if we want to revisit in February, if there's kind of anything that kind of points us in that direction. I think for right now, we have a good amount planned, or, you know, in progress and planning. Any other maybe subcommittees we need to form here? So I definitely heard the kind of subcommittee around the potential Pride event in the spring, summer timeframe. Do we need to have a subcommittee for this food truck festival? If we, you know, want to try to make some progress on that, we probably should put a small group together.
Well, you already have a group for it to work with ESME. So you need an additional group to talk about the Pride Day and then what would surround it. Do you need new people for that, or can you go with Amy at all?
Yeah, I was thinking that Pride event would not be the food truck event, but maybe somebody clarify that for me. It sounded like we were trying to aim for two potential activities there.
When was the training going to be, Amy, that you were looking into with Liza again?
We didn't decide on anything. I just emailed her and asked her about her availability.
So I think from a timing perspective, while I agree some people are zoomed out for sure, I feel like doing something virtual is appropriate for March. And I don't think we'll have enough time to wait until February to figure it out and decide on it. So I feel like if we want to do something in March, we should decide and vote on it now and give an update next month to see where we are. So whether it's a training or whether it's a listening session. But I think waiting until like Hazardous Waste Day at the end of April is maybe too long without an event or a touch point with the community.
Well, if Liza could do March, that would be fabulous. And I'd be happy to work with you on Amy on setting that up or whatever.
Okay.
And I would cover that.
You know, I also think that we could have the listening session in our back pocket. And, you know, there have been times when like that whole pronoun conversation happened on social media in Easton, where I wish we had, you know, something prepared in response to kind of like jump in and address something that was really relevant. I don't know how we can just be more timely, I guess. Find a way to be more timely. Because it's a really awesome lineup, and I know people are burnt, but I'd go.
If you want to expand on what you were saying about the training.
Oh, I don't have anything. I feel like there are two virtual options for March, right? One would be a training with Liza, but I just emailed her, so we don't even know if she's available or willing. And then the other one is to continue working on the sexuality listening session that we kind of already had a lineup of people interested to help out with.
That sounds reasonable to me, like at this point, to say our tentative plan for March is to do one of those two, and then
okay,
the two committees, you know, or whomever, just say like, where does Eliza thing go? And if that doesn't work out, you know, exploring a listening session, especially if we feel like at this point, we've kind of got the pattern down and even the speakers at this point.
And then Michelle, this was in reference to the email that went out yesterday about the Easton schools and their kind of listening series. I know they have somebody coming up in January. Mm-hmm. Is there a way in which we can, and it's probably out there, I just don't know where it is, we know when and who is speaking coming up? Because I do think, you know,
more like a calendar of upcoming?
Yeah, and I just wonder, right, we talk about this collaboration with the school department. If they can, we can kind of jump onto theirs, they can jump onto ours. I think that we don't have to be so siloed and just in moving forward, just break down those walls even more.
So I'll bring that up in my meeting with Leisha. Maybe you and I can also bring it up at the superintendent advisory. But I think
it's
yeah, and I'm sure there's a list of, you know, for the upcoming year.
Yeah, I mean, I think back, and I know that sometimes you can't, I don't know if there's a way, you know, folks who are teachers probably have more insight than this, but if you can get so many hours, if what would we need to do to qualify our listening sessions to equate some sort of hours, or would that work? Would we not want to do this? Because I don't know, I think that some of the listening sessions that we've had, especially about, you know, gender identity, would be incredibly well served for our K through 12 folks to go through, not just, you know, my mother was a secretary and she used to get, you know, hours or something when she did it. So I think that that something like that, kind of fostering that relationship, might be helpful. And I know that, you know, we, because of COVID, we weren't able to meet, but we're now starting to meet more as the superintendent committee. So I think that might be helpful.
It might ultimately land on Chrissy if we're looking to for teachers to get PLUs for it, but we can at least start that conversation. It's a great idea.
Yeah, I mean, and if they don't, that's fine too. I mean, I don't know how that all works, but at least encourage folks and let them know that something's coming up. I've never met a teacher that it's a lack of interest. It sometimes just comes lack of, they didn't know or there wasn't enough time to plan.
Agreed. All right.
I thought I'd send that out to our ally list, okay?
What specifically?
The event.
EPS?
The event that...
Oh, the school one. Yeah.
That would be great. Thank you.
Sure.
But yeah, that's an excellent point, Beth, about those hours of training to see if there's any... what that entails to kind of qualify as the appropriate level of training, and you know how we could make sure that that gets somehow embedded into our listening sessions or into our coursework that we try to put forward. So I think that's an excellent point.
Yeah, I mean, I think if we were doing, you know, if we did a seminar on inherent bias or even what critical race theory is and isn't, whatever those are, not just our listening sessions that maybe not, might not qualify because they're more speaking. I have no idea what the qualifications are, but I do think that we have more quote academic type speakers who come in, which I know for a fact, Liza goes and speaks to schools. So why wouldn't they be able to get credit if they were able to log on or, you know, kind of prove that they were there?
Great idea. Let's see what we can do.
All right, great. So it sounds like we'll try to pursue a spring or a March in particular kind of training event, and whether or not that is training or listening session. So whether that is with Liza, do we have any other options in terms of folks that, or you know, folks within our network that we could lean on to conduct a training for us outside of Liza, just in case March is not feasible for her, to cover a topic like unconscious bias, or maybe what is critical race theory, or you know, a discussion around privilege. Anybody come to mind?
Well, as I said, RMK is on critical race theory, and I think by March we'll have something, and we'll be co-sponsoring it. But also we had already planned a listening session on sexual identity. And I think we've got two or three speakers in line. So we could probably pull that together pretty quickly.
Okay.
Right, okay. Michelle, some people and...
Yeah, I think that's what Amy was saying a little bit ago, that we can revisit that and see if we can pull that together. Because we definitely had people that were interested in doing it.
Also going back to the discussion with Chrissy, like if they have someone or something lined up, then maybe that's already done.
Okay. All right. So it sounds like we have some options for March. I also think maybe Irene had a contact who was doing some training as well. Does that sound familiar to anyone? I'll reach out to her just in case too, as a additional option. Okay, so that takes us to at least, I think it actually kind of covers the year in terms of activities. So okay, wait, so back to the food truck festival. So it sounds like we have a subcommittee focus on our Pride event that we'll aim to have maybe later in the spring or summer time frame. What about kind of the food truck festival, tea dance activity to align with something around maybe summer concert with the rec that Michelle brought up, and maybe some of the other summertime activities that happen in town that we could potentially leverage? Are we ready to maybe form a smaller group to start to think about what that would look like?
The Pride event?
Yeah.
I think say we had some folks. I thought we
say
did.
That again. Sorry.
I thought that we said we had people, but I don't know, maybe I was thinking about the other one. And also, I don't know if this, how it works as far as the town pool. Do we ever do any events down there?
I don't, although there aren't that many people that can fit at the town pool, I don't think.
Mm. We could talk to Ann. I'm on the rec commission too, so any of those rec-related things I can try to help bridge it out for.
Well, and just practically too, like June is kind of the earliest we would do any sort of food truck event. So if it doesn't work out to do it with what we're doing for any kind of Pride celebration, as we move more into spring and know more what June's going to look like, then we can maybe shift that to an August event.
I vote for the product that includes food truck. It gets as many people as we can. But they might people in Pride events, they might be trucks, and we could get them there. Mm-hmm.
Kathy, you were fading in and out. I didn't catch all of that.
There's a lot of feedback. I was just saying for a Pride event food trucks, but I think in more people.
So okay. Maybe I'm getting the events confused, but what were we trying to maybe collaborate with Esme on?
Pride event.
Okay. And that could be a food truck thing?
Yes. I will bring that up when I talk to Esme. And then if anyone else wants in on the food truck action, I will report back at the next meeting and maybe I can get help with that part. Because I don't have any connections.
Okay, I have no connections, but I love food. So if there's an opportunity to help support that in any way I can. Okay, all right. So that's why everybody's talking about it as one thing. I get that now. I'm good, team. I'm good. All right. Fall, we are all set. And then the holidays, we want to continue to participate in the parade. Okay, all right. I think that kind of takes us through the year. And as things come up and other topics come through that we feel like we want to incorporate, we can definitely shift, but at least it's kind of good to at least have something in place that we can move towards. Okay, so the next agenda topic would be the RMK kind of activities and updates. Particularly, this was last month's focus was around the proclamation. So, you know, I was not able to attend last month's meeting, but I did watch the meeting afterwards to kind of understand what discussions took place. And it was a good amount of conversation around the proclamation. It seems as though there is maybe some frustration with kind of the lack of progress we've been able to make to kind of get to a finalization around being able to move forward with the proclamation and get it distributed. I do want, you know, especially for our committee members to know, you know, there was a lot of activity that happened in 2021 around the proclamation. So I started to put together a timeline because I thought it would be important for the group to just understand what activities occurred and leading up to discussions that maybe took place last month. So Allie, do you mind pulling that up real quick? Thank you. And I don't know if everybody can kind of see that clearly or not. But I wanted to walk through this because I felt like it was important for folks to see, you know, what took place. So in 2020, around the November timeframe, a few of us met with RMK and we kind of talked through the concern that was brought forward about the stickers. So folks, maybe who are not speaking, can you go on mute? Because I am hearing some feedback. We met with them.
Sorry, I don't know what's happening right now. Hold on.
Okay. I think you might be the person giving us feedback.
I am.
I think so.
Really? Hold on.
Is your face popped up? Would that be my talking?
It's totally quiet in here. That's very strange. All right, hold on. Let's see. Can you guys see it now?
It says you're starting to share screen. Okay, yeah. So November, we met with a group. Kristen shared the concern around the stickers that she found at her workplace. And we talked about, you know, what we could do in terms of our reaction to that. And there was a discussion about putting out a statement. And then, you know, we talked about what a statement does and whether or not, you know, that was going to provide enough action to go ahead and put out. We could easily put out an HRC statement, put it on our website, and you know, speak to why we think that was an inappropriate action and how we felt about it. But what we talked about was the opportunity to provide a more action-focused response. And so what we did in the next month was we came up with the idea around working with the Oliver Ames High School to go ahead and put together an art campaign. And this, we worked in collaboration with the art director, Ms. Shea, to go ahead and encourage students to submit symbols and images that depict diversity that we would then choose as a winner. We actually chose, I think we narrowed down to 5 top artists, but we would choose a winner and that would then become kind of our symbol that would go against, and we would create stickers out of them kind of in complete contrast to the negative stickers that were being distributed. So we launched that campaign in December and was able to kind of move that forward in that month, which was, you know, pretty crazy considering the collaboration with the school and being able to kind of get it all in before the holidays, but we did. And then in January, we worked with RMK and they helped us create a voting website so that this way town members could go ahead and choose the winning image. Kristen and I actually narrowed down to the top 5 images and then we worked with RMK. They put together the voting site. And we were able to solicit input from the community on the chosen winner for the art contest. And we received almost 500 votes. So definitely some strong community engagement there that we were pretty excited about. In February, we announced the winner of the art contest. We were able to, thanks to RMK, even sponsor prizes to the artists. And then we worked to go ahead and get that artwork onto stickers and decals for distribution. And as you know, we even created t-shirts down the line for distribution as well. So the artwork is definitely becoming, you know, a great symbol in terms of identification of HRC and diversity. Then in March, Denise Lane from the proclamation committee, they ended up forming a proclamation committee to kind of talk through the opportunity to put forward a proclamation to the town. And so that was actually going to go hand in hand with the artwork in terms of distribution across the community. And we put forward an HRC representative, and at the time it was Stephanie, to go ahead and be part of that proclamation writing committee as that was being developed. A few months later, we received a first draft of that proclamation, and I think it was Liz and I at that time provided some feedback to that the writing committee on some thoughts that we had around the initial draft. And then we didn't really hear much back. So it was summertime, you know, things definitely got quiet. So it wasn't until around the September timeframe that Denise reached out to us within the HRC and said that the proclamation writing committee had regrouped and they were going to be restarting to try to move forward towards finalization. And they sent a draft to the HRC to review. We noticed that, you know, some of the feedback that we provided in that that spring timeframe did not necessarily get addressed. So we then kind of distributed across the committee. Each of the committee members went ahead and provided some feedback, and we collaborated and kind of culminated all that feedback and put forward our response to the proclamation writing committee for review. In November, we received a note that said that our revisions kind of changed the intent of the proclamation, and that were still kind of in review, but were likely not going to be accepted. And then the December meeting occurred, and that's where we landed. Yep.
Sorry to interrupt. I just can't scroll down, so I'm going to stop sharing and open it again in a second.
Okay, that's fine. That's fine. And there's probably not much more left on it that I can't speak to. But ultimately, you know, that kind of is what led to our December meeting. So when I heard kind of the concerns around the delay or kind of the slowness of getting to the finalization of the proclamation, I was kind of disappointed to hear that. I feel like HRC has been a pretty strong partner to the proclamation committee, and we most definitely, you know, can see that we would like to move that forward, but there have been delays in terms of the feedback that we've provided, reaction to our feedback, and we haven't been able to move towards finalization quite yet. So after the last meeting, we did go ahead and make the changes based on the December discussion, which was to shift from the town of Easton to the town of Easton's HRC. We also had some additional questions, and we sent that over a few weeks after our meeting. Denise actually emailed me today. Unfortunately, the writing committee has not had the opportunity to review that feedback and provide us any responses yet, which is why we're going to go ahead and table any further discussion around the proclamation or any voting till February, until we do have an opportunity to receive the answers to the inquiries that we sent over in December. So that's where we stand in terms of the proclamation. I wanted to make sure this group was kind of well aware of that, but any questions for me on this timeline?
I think it's 1-4-22 at the bottom there, not 1-4-21. Oh, yeah. And I thought we had decided that given this document that the committee was comfortable, I think the committee's comfortable with it, we were going to say this is the document that the Human Rights Committee is going to send out.
No, so actually, based on the last review, Craig, we've provided comments over to the Proclamation Writing Committee, and they've not answered any of our questions around some of the comments that we had. So we've asked about the intent of the attestation. There's a comment around programming. That programming wouldn't be limited to the HRC, so we asked for additional clarification around it. I can forward you the exchange, but we have some outstanding questions that, if not resolved, I don't think we can move forward with the voting.
Okay.
Basically, when we changed the wording from Town of Easton to Town of Easton's Human Rights Committee, it made it sound a little bit as though we were promising to do a bunch of programming that we needed some clarification on. So that was the main question, I think, that we had.
That's reasonable.
So we very much look forward to finalization and moving it forward. We hope that it can go hand in hand with the sticker project, which was the original intent. And we will look to hopefully moving to a vote by February. So more to come. But wanted to make sure this group was was informed with a kind of process throughout the year around that. Okay, excellent. Any other RMK activities that we want to discuss today?
As I said, we're working with them on a critical race theory listening session, but there have not been any meetings recently, so I'll keep you posted.
Thanks, Kathy.
And thank you, Karen, for working on that project, because the proclamation, it's a tricky issue, and you guys are doing a great job.
Thanks, Kathy. Yeah, I definitely something new for the HRC. That's, the first time we've kind of been asked to move something like that forward. So definitely a learning process for us as well. Okay, for other action items, one thing I did want to put out there, I know our next, so we've been kind of talking through what we do, at least at the beginning of the year, is just whether or not this meeting schedule works for everyone. So I definitely wanted to circle back with the group and see if this first Tuesday of every month still works for the group at 6:30 p.m. Because if that's the case, we'll go ahead and I'll, kind of work with the town to make sure we have the Zoom scheduled and can move that forward. So maybe I'll start with any concerns with sticking to the schedule.
It's not ideal for me, but I can make it work.
Okay, thanks, Liz. Because it seems like it does work for everyone, so maybe it's just better not to change it. So with that said, unfortunately or fortunately, the February meeting does fall on Lunar New Year, and I will be observing it. So I'm good with somebody else facilitating the meeting, or I'm open to seeing if the group wants to move it back. No pressure. I don't want to change everybody's schedule, and then it'll kind of trickle down into messing us up for March and so on and so forth. So maybe we just end up sticking with it. But the next meeting will be February 1st.
I can't attend that meeting.
Okay.
I don't have maybe a problem with moving it to the 8th and then just going back to the first Tuesday in the month.
I can do the 8th.
For other folks?
I can do the 1st, I can do the 8th, whichever.
I can do either.
I vote for the
8th. Okay, great. Thank you, everyone. We'll move that one to the 8th then. I think Irene will be celebrating Lunar New Year as well. Okay, perfect. Okay, the next topic is public participation, and we do have public
participation. Wait, sorry, can I do one other action item before public participation?
Oh, yep, sorry, go ahead.
So at the last meeting, there was a comment about ordering more shirts, either for our personal use or other people who wanted to purchase them. And I'm happy to coordinate that. We have to go through the same process with the town to get the funding for the shirts. So, I can do it the same way as before or work with the town to purchase the shirts directly, but we have to go to the select board to ask for that money from the Stonehill pot to use for that purpose.
How much are they?
They were, I think, 16 a piece, which is the least expensive unit price I could get for the quantity that we ordered at the time, which I believe was 20.
So tell me a little bit more, Liz, around the interest. Was it beyond maybe Irene's?
I don't know. I also could not make the December meeting. So I think there were positive reactions to the shirts when we wore them during the Lions Club parade. And people saying, oh, that's nice. I'd like one of those. Where can I get one of those? So I think that's where the interest came from.
So our idea would be to sell them, correct?
Possibly, although I guess, Craig, this is maybe a question for town council about whether a town committee is allowed to sell things and whether we sell them at cost or at a marginal profit and what happens to the proceeds.
Sell them, the proceeds go back to the town for the use of the HRC.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I can ask the question, but I'm pretty sure that that's that's fine.
So if we got some, we have a long time to sell them. Not like you have to do it really quickly.
Mm-hmm.
So we'd have them available at future events.
And how many do you have to order, Liz, in order to knock that price down?
I don't know, because at the time we weren't considering ordering more. Mm-hmm. I think maybe you get into like 3 dozen and you start to hit some different margins. And the question also came up about ordering kid sizes, which we didn't look into since that wasn't our purpose at the time. So that might have a slightly different unit price, but you could also see if we go to the children's races in August, maybe that's a good draw sort of thing. Mm-hmm. So it sounds like there's no urgency for this, and this can be tabled for as a February agenda item to talk about more.
Well, I mean, I think it's either a yes or a no, right? So it's either we think that we have an opportunity to distribute these and we have, you know, we'll get enough interest. And it sounds like we're going to have kind of in-person events would be our goal in 2022. So especially events that are outside and kind of amongst big groups. And, you know, I could see us having the opportunity to distribute for sure. So I guess why not? Why not move it forward? Because at the very least, we're going to continue to have participation in as volunteers for different events and parades and, you know, to be able to have that kind of going forward. It's a minimal investment.
Okay. So
I say yes, but
I can look into pricing options for the February meeting.
Okay, great. Thank you. Any other, any other action items or open topics before I move to public participation? Great. So, Pastor John Polk of the Holy Trinity Lutheran Church in Easton has joined, and I'm going to promote the panelists so that Pastor John can go ahead and address the group, because in the Q&A, there was some discussion around an opportunity for collaboration. So I wanted to give John that opportunity to share that with the group.
Hi.
Hi, Pastor Polk. How are
Thank you
today?
Thank you for joining.
I'm good. Thank you for having me. Each year on November 20th, our congregation, which is a welcoming and affirming congregation, hosts a Transgender Day of Remembrance service. On that day, on November 20th, all across the country, such services are held to honor and remember those who have been brutally murdered because of who they are. And we host such a meeting service every year here at the church. The service is designed to welcome all people and is not grounded in any particular belief system, but designed to welcome all people of all different kinds of belief systems or no belief systems. And it includes special music, it includes a reading of the names, it includes special speakers, one of whom this last year was Dottie, who referred me to all of you. And we also happen to have a person who happens to be trans as a speaker. We happen to have a couple of youth in our church who are going through transition, and they've been speakers as well. And I'd simply like to invite the committee to consider collaborating with us in some fashion by perhaps hosting it with us or being a part of it. But I just wanted to draw it to your attention and invite you to consider being a part of it and collaborating with us. It's proven to be an important gathering for the community each year. We started it when I came here about 3 years ago.
Thank you. Yes, thank you for coming today to introduce the topic to us and for the invitation. I think that it most definitely aligns to our mission and vision as a human rights committee for our town. And I think that we would definitely have interest. So you mentioned this is closer to November? I'm sorry, November timeframe?
It's on November 20th every year all across the country on that date.
Okay. So So when do you start to begin planning activities?
Usually in the summertime.
Okay. Okay, excellent. Any questions or feedback from the committee?
Question. I think it's great. I would love to participate. What kind of turnout do you get here in Easton for these events?
This last time in November, we had about 40 people, which was up about 10 people from 2 years ago. We didn't do it the year in between because of the pandemic, but the in-person ones the last one was about 40 people.
Great, thank you.
Sure. And besides our TDOR service, I'm also very interested in working with you and collaborating with the committee on other events and projects too. So it's been interesting to hear your committee work. I'm all for it and eager. Our congregation is eager to work with you and to promote the work that you're doing. I think you're doing fabulous work, and it's really critically important in our community.
Thank you.
Thank you for that.
Thank you. I want to make sure you're on our ally list. Are you on our ally list?
I don't know. I'd love to be.
Okay. All right.
How do I get on it?
We'll just take down your email information, and we'll make sure that we get that over to Kathy, and she'll get you on the list. And then this way you'll be made aware of any events and activities and all the training that we discussed today, and any potential listening sessions or food truck events. You'll be well aware of those as they come about.
And the parade too. Maybe I can help with that in the what, next
week. Oh, yes. Absolutely. Great. And I'll be sure to reach out to you maybe just, you know, kind of beginning of the summer or end of the spring, just to go ahead and begin that collaboration for the November event.
Okay. We've also been promoting the service in the high school through Dr. Cabral's help. So we try to invite and attract young people too, who are passionate about this and going through transition.
Excellent.
Great. Thank you very much for listening. And I look forward to finding ways to collaborate with the work that you're doing.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor.
Thanks again for joining.
Sure. Karen, can I ask a question or just to the group? Should we have a point person, kind of like we do with RMK, who, you know, we partner with a lot to keep in touch?
Yeah, we can definitely do that. We can definitely do that. And you know, if you have interest as a committee member, you want to reach out to me after the meeting, you can go ahead and assign someone. That would be great. Okay, I don't know how to actually unpanel someone. Anybody know how to do that?
Do I need to leave? I'll leave.
No, don't leave. You don't have to leave. I just need to figure out how to unpanel you. Anyone? No.
I can't see your controls, but sometimes when you go to participants and you hover over their name,
No, please don't leave. Oh, okay. I mean, if I remove as a panelist, will they just go back to participants?
Maybe.
Okay. If by chance I hang up on you, John, I'm very sorry.
No worries.
Thank you again for joining.
Sure. Thank you.
Yeah, it says if I remove John, he will not be able to rejoin. So I think.
That's okay.
Oh, geez. Okay, I'm really bad at this. Okay. So I think at this point, we're actually moving to adjourn. So our next meeting will be February 8th. Any last topics from the group at this point?
I just want to add the comment I put in the chat. So our allies could be a great resource to help plan events. I don't know if there's anything improper about that, but that might be something to consider for 2022.
Yeah, that's an excellent point.
As well as
we do really well with collaborative partners.
Dramatically expanding our ally list. There are all these people who are out there, they want to be on our list, they just don't know about it. We need to tap into them.
Kathy, I can see you with billboards in 2022 with a sandwich board at our next event.
Walking in front of Farmer's Daughter over and over.
Oh, goodness. All right. Well, this has been a very productive meeting. I do want you to, I do hope you reflect on our 2021 accomplishments, because we really did. We really did do a lot in a very challenging year. This committee did accomplish a lot. So I thank you for your continued partnership and focus and volunteerism for this committee, because I know that it's challenging, especially considering all of our competing priorities. But it's, you know, we are making a difference, and it's exciting to see that kind of come through. So I'm looking forward to 2022. I'll see you all on February 8th, and thank you. We'll go ahead and adjourn. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved, Barger.
Second?
Second, Devonshire.
All right, let's vote.
Barger, yes.
Go.
Yep, Barger, yes.
Devonshire, yes.
Durant, yes.
Foster, yes.
Hirschman, yes.
Oh, yes.
Churchill, yes.
And yes. Thank you, everyone. Have a great night.
Stay safe, everybody. Take care.
Thank you.